Good evening, and welcome to the sixth chapter of the One Book, One Minnesota Statewide Book Club, tonight featuring Kao Kalia Yang, author of The Song Poet, A Memoir of My Father. The One Book, One Minnesota program is presented by the Minnesota Center for the Book in partnership with the State Library Service and sponsored by Spire Credit Union. I'm Elaine Hopkins, Director of Programs and Services for the Friends of the St. Paul Public Library, which is the Library of Congress designated Minnesota Center for the Book. As such, we present programming that reaches all corners of our state and promotes reading, libraries, and our state's literary legacy. As we get started this evening, we would like to take a moment to acknowledge the Dakota people, indigenous keepers of the land from which we broadcast tonight. This land was reserved by the Dakota in the Treaty of Traverse des Sioux, signed with the United States in 1851, and it remains sacred to them today. I also want to acknowledge the Ojibwe people, fellow indigenous inhabitants of this land. Dakota and Ojibwe people are also the original stewards of stories in this place now called Minnesota, and we at the Friends honor that tradition and the knowledge and values embedded in it as we work to lift up storytellers in our state today. I'd also like to thank our partners, the Council of Regional Public Library Systems Administrators, Mackin VIA, Macmillan Publishers, Minitex, the Minnesota Department of Education, and Recorded Books. This program is made possible in part by the voters of Minnesota, thanks to a legislative appropriation from the Arts and Cultural Heritage Fund, as well as through a grant from the National Endowment for the Arts. Our program this evening is being captioned by Megan Stumm of Veritext. If you're using the captions, you can click on the link in the chat, which opens the live captioning in a new browser. Thank you so much for your work tonight, Megan. So since we created the One Book, One Minnesota program in April of 2020, Minnesotans from nearly every county in the state have downloaded books by Minnesota writers more than 63,000 times. Tonight, we're thrilled to welcome attendees from all over the state, and thank you all for making this program such a success. The Friends offers programs like this to connect readers and writers across the state. We are so grateful for the generosity of each writer who chooses to share their personal stories, and we respect what they choose to share. We also appreciate our audience's desire to learn from these writers and their experiences. The Friends is committed to building a culture that embraces diversity, equity, and inclusion. For our programming specifically, this means that we convene and lift up voices from all different backgrounds. We also work to ensure that our participants, both readers and writers, feel accepted, valued, and celebrated. Thank you so much for choosing to spend your time with us this evening. We hope that even in this virtual setting, you feel part of this incredible Minnesota community. We're glad you're here. So now I am incredibly honored to introduce our featured guest, Kao Kalia Yang. Kalia Yang is an award-winning Hmong American writer. She's the author of the memoirs, The Latehomecomer, The Song Poet, and Somewhere in the Unknown World. She has also written many children's books, A Map into the World, The Shared Room, The Most Beautiful Thing, and most recently, From the Tops of the Trees and Yang Warriors. She also co-edited the essay collection, What God is Honored Here, Writings on Miscarriage and Infant Loss by and for Indigenous Women and Women of Color. Kalia's literary nonfiction work has been recognized by the National Endowment for the Arts, the National Book Critics Circle Award, the Chautauqua Prize, the Penn USA Literary Awards, the Dayton Literary Peace Prize, and garnered 4 Minnesota Book Awards. She is the recipient of the McKnight Fellowship in Prose, the International Institute of Minnesota's Olga Zoltai Award for Community Leadership and Service to New Americans, and the Ordway Center for the Performing Arts 2019 Sally Award for Social Impact. Welcome, Kalia. We are so glad that you're here with us this evening.
Thank you so much, Elaine. Good evening, everyone. I'm coming to you from my office in St. Paul. So my kids are outside. Just a note, they're outside in case they come and peek.
I am in sympathy with you with that because mine are also outside the door here. So I'm just so thrilled to be with you. I wish it was in person, but virtually here tonight. I have had the privilege of traveling around the state and doing events with you all over, and it's really been an honor for us at the Friends to be able to work with you. And so I'm so delighted to be able to talk with you tonight about the song poet. So we have collected questions from readers all over the state and have some of our own. And one thing that several people brought up, and it struck me too, as we like dive right in here, is how it worked for you, the actual process of putting this book together, the gathering of the stories, and then the decision that you made around the voices, the first person voice of your father on the side A and then your own in side B. And I would love to hear, and I know many readers would, how that came about for you.
First, it's been such an honor, Elaine. We've in many ways walked parallel roads, you know, this journey for me into books and then for you with the Friends. So it's really an honor to be in conversation tonight. The song poet began because my father had just lost his job. Every day he would get ready for work, put on his uniform, but he'd have nowhere to go. It began because every single day my father's eyes grew redder and redder. He'd been the insurance carrier in our family, and when he lost his job, him and 14 other Hmong co-workers, we didn't have medical coverage anymore. And so he was trying to space out his medication. And one day I said to him, perhaps to get him to look at me, I said, Daddy, you know, what if my next book is about you? He looked and for a moment he smiled, and then he said, nobody wants to read a book about a man like me. We live in a world where presidents can write books about themselves. Why would anyone want to read a book about a man like me with rough hands? His hands are incredibly rough. He'd spent most of his life in America in the factories as a machinist. And so my stubborn heart, I set myself on this path in many ways to prove my father wrong. You know, my whole life as a writer, I think it was made possible because of the things I saw from my father's shoulders. Long before I had a bike or a car, knew what a car was, planes and trains, it was on the strength of my father's shoulders that I rested. He was my vehicle into a bigger world. And on his shoulders, he showed me all of the beautiful things. On those shoulders, I learned how to dream. And in many ways, as I had become a writer, I wanted to enlarge the parameters of those dreams for me, but also for himself. And so I set out to do this book. And as I was writing it, just writing it out, all of these stories that he had told me all across the long years of our lives together, I'd say, Daddy, do you want to know what I'm writing? And he'd say to me, no, you can tell me when you're done with the book. I've seen too much great art die in talk. Don't do this to yourself. And so he gave me absolute freedom to go about it in the ways that I thought the story needed to be told. And that's my approach to it. I told it in the ways that I thought the story needed to be told, the ways in which the stories are most real to me as his daughter, knowing at the onset that I would not be able to do perhaps justice to his poetry, the depth of his poetry, or the yearning in his heart, but also knowing that if I didn't do it, who would? Who would actually sit to listen to the story of Bia, who might carry you across a language, across a culture, into a bigger world? And so it was this task. I knew that it wouldn't be perfect, but if you know anything about me, you know that I do not look for perfection in my art or in my life. I'm looking for a gentler kind of beauty, an imperfect kind of love. And so that's what this is, a project of love. I knew in many ways that I had to be structured like a cassette, because my father, when I was just a kid, as I wrote in The Song Poet, he came out with an album of song poetry, and he was always going to do a second. But of course, like so many poor kids, when you know that your mom and dad have a little bit of money, all of a sudden your needs grow in proportion to those dollar bills. And so that second album never happened. Plus, the cassette tape is particularly important to the Hmong culture. In the long years of waiting in the refugee camps, we communicated with the world through our tapes. We communicated across nation states through our tapes. And so I wanted to commemorate all of the Hmong history, as well as this art that my father has spent all of my life loving.
I was saying a little bit before we started that not only was I reading the physical book, but I was listening to the audiobook, which you do so beautifully, and that structure with the tracks was really particularly apparent as I was listening to it, and it felt like it had even more resonance via the audiobook, and it made perfect sense. As I was getting to the end of the book, or maybe wherever it switches over into side B, I was really, really pleased that you then came back in to fill out the portrait of your father, and really loved having that counterpoint of voices, and then the duet at the end. So it when you have just one perspective, you get that, even though you wrote it all, but when you just have that one perspective, sometimes you're wondering, okay, well, what's behind that, or where did that come in? What was the impact on the other people around the central character? And so I really appreciated the experience of the book in that way.
I love that. Yeah, I love that because, you know, my dad is a song poet. In the tradition of song poetry, you have duets sometimes. Fathers and daughters can sing together. And in many ways, when I was just a child, I once watched the Music Award videos, and there was a special where Nat King Cole, a video of him came up, and Natalie was able to sing with him. And I always thought in my head and my heart, that is so beautiful. You know, perhaps one day when I grow up, I might be able to sing with my father. But of course, life doesn't give us all of our dreams. And so I never was able to, I don't have the voice capacity. As my father says, sometimes when I sing, it's a little bothersome. So this was in many ways my way of paying tribute to the form, but also my chance to sing with my dad.
Mm-hmm. That comes clear. Yeah. I mean, it just comes through so clearly. Yeah. And that is actually a perfect segue into something else that I was experiencing as I was reading it, particularly in that the very first section of the book, as you are in the introduction, really, when you are talking about really recognizing your father, maybe for the first time, but having that realization of him as a poet, as an artist, and then really quickly following that, your understanding that your father also didn't expect his family to recognize him as an artist. And this idea about art and storytelling and responsibility, like the responsibility maybe that creates. And I'm wondering how you feel that resonance also as an artist and a storyteller. And I think of, you know, you've had a lot of acclaim, rightly so. And I think maybe a lot of weight is put on your shoulders as a memoirist of Hmong people.
I love this question because I have little kids. So my boys, my identical twin boys are 6 and my daughter is 8. And now, you know, the 8-year-old reads and the 6-year-old, the both of them are beginning to read as well. And so when they see my books in their libraries, they'll come back and they'll look at me and they'll be like, you don't look like your other photo. And I'm like, not all the time and not every day. It's a high expectation. You know, we have these conversations. And then I think about my father's art, and in many ways, because it is an art that disappears once he is off stage, that disappears once the song ends. There is no physical object for the longest time for me to hold or to be able to measure my father against a bigger world's perceptions of him, perhaps, or even just within the Hmong community. It took me a long time to realize that he was a poet. And in that realization, there was also this understanding that he was no longer just mine, you know? And I think my children don't have that. They don't yet have that complication. You know, I'm their mother, and then I'm also the author of these books at their school. or in the libraries, which we all love. We're big library fans here. And so it's an interesting thing in terms of the responsibility question, Elaine. I've been at this for a long time. I started writing at the age of 22, writing The Latehomecomer, what would become my first book. When I was 27, it emerged into the world. And one of the things that I realized was, as much as I didn't know about literary America also doesn't know about me. And so in many ways, I wanted to meet this world that I was entering into. I wanted to meet this role that I was stepping into as genuinely and as authentically as I can. And because you've been a part of my journey for a long time, you've seen me mature and you've seen me grow as a writer. But that process has always been transparent for me, which is to say that, I don't expect perfection. My best try is enough. And if it isn't, then I'm going to give myself a second and a third. The strongest part of me is my heart. I'm a tiny, tiny human being with a small, soft voice, tiny hands, soft hands of a writer. I build the world I live in with my heart. And that engine inside of me is much stronger than I ever knew it could be. You know, there is responsibility. In responsibility, there's also a kind of power that is granted. I know this because I'm a big sister as well. You know, when you choose different schools for your younger siblings, or when you give them certain perspectives about certain courses, you're kind of responsible for what happens, even without knowing. And so I try to do my research and I try to be thoughtful. And in many ways, if I'm a leader at all, I lead with authenticity. Like, this is me and I'm going to learn as much as I can. We're going to make the best possible decisions we know how to make on the page and off of it. But that the art I do is the life I live is something that I've completely, I think, embodied. You know, now almost 20 years after the beginning, because I turn 41 next week. I think it's been such a delightful journey in that way. When you're young, you think that maybe you don't have room to make a lot of mistakes. But then you get older and you realize that there's art in living with one's mistakes and building something beautiful from what has been broken.
That is, as usual, a really lovely way to track that artistic journey. And I do appreciate it, because I remember going way back, one of the events that we did, I had just started at the Friends, or I was relatively new at the Friends when we partnered with Coffee House Press around the launch of The Latehomecomer. So it's really, it has been a true privilege to see the way you share your heart with everyone around you and the readers. And so I appreciate that. Thank you. And I would, if you don't mind continuing in that vein, would you read a passage from The Song Poet for us?
I would be delighted. It's been a while since I've read from this book, so a part of my heart has been waiting for tonight. Thank you.
Yes.
The Song Poet by Kao Kalia Yang, a memoir of my father. Dedication. For the suns that rise on the horizons we've yet to see, for my brothers and sisters, my sons and daughters. For my father Mbiya, who sings his lonely songs so that we may hear the trembling of the still fluttering heart. And it opens with an epigraph. Gutia is, in the words of Ralph Ellison on American Blues, an impulse to keep the painful details and episodes of a brutal experience alive in one's aching consciousness, to finger its jagged grain and to transcend it. Not by the consolation of philosophy, but by squeezing from a near-tragic, near-cosmic lyricism. As a form, the blues is an autobiographical chronicle of personal catastrophe expressed lyrically. Gutia's songs can be duets, the voices of fathers and daughters coming together, different verses within the same song, stanzas in the same poem. And the part I will be from is track 9, if anybody at home is following along. In the hardcover, it is page 222, Dreams and Nightmares. It is the same dream. It is the same nightmare. My mother and I are on our way to the garden. I am young, maybe 3 or 4. and she holds my hand firmly in hers. Her gait is uneven, so I mirror it with my walk. First, one step to the right, a small bend in the knees, and then one to the left, another bend in the knees. I see the familiar tree and the beloved rock. It is a fat, stout tree. Its leaves are heavy with an uneven cloud of green atop the thick trunk. The rock is only a rock, but it is the rock that my mother sits on to hold me in her lap on our visit to the garden every day. My mother tells me that it is the rock she sat on to nurse me when I was a baby. In the dream, we are happy. I can smell the fresh morning dew on the grass and feel a slight wetness to the leaves from the bushes as they touch my shoulders along the path. The sun is bright. The morning sky is a clear light blue with patches of white clouds trailing along the horizon, evaporating slowly in the growing heat of the day. In the nightmare, I know what will happen. The sound of metal sliced air up high seems like a rocket speeding across the blue, coming closer to my mother and me. Just as we are approaching the tree and the rocket falls in front of us. There is a sound of wood splintering and rock exploding. The air is a fog of debris. I lose my mother. I hear her frantic voice yelling my name. B, B, B. The last word I can make out is the noise is run. I run from the smoke. My hands are in the air. Both palms are wide open. I want to call back to my mother, but the debris has entered my mouth. I try to wet my mouth with my tongue. All I feel is something jagged. Rocks, teeth, I do not know. I wake up from the dream and the nightmare. My hands are shaking uncontrollably. In the palm of my right hand, I can feel a remnant of rock embedded. I look in the gray dawn streaming in through the Minnesota night, but I see nothing. I feel my right hand with my left, but I find only hard flesh, torn and mended by machines and time. I cannot stop the shaking in my hands. I cannot dislodge the feeling of the rock that has pierced my flesh, even as I massage and massage my throbbing palm. At the dining table, in the light of the morning, my children watch me. They notice the shaking of my right hand on the table beside my plate. They do not say anything. I tell them about the dream and the nightmare. I tell them, it is only a rock, but it is the rock that my mother sat on to nurse me. You cannot see it, but I can feel the rock in my hand. I close my palms, willing the fingers of my right hand to cover the rock of memory protruding from my flesh. And then further along in that same track, on page 231 in the hardcover, the loss of my father's poetry dawned on me on a beautiful April day. I was driving my father's truck. Outside, there was a light drizzle. The smell of wet earth entered through the open windows. It was 60 degrees, the warmest day we'd experienced in Minnesota since early October. The snow was gone. The grass was beginning to show green along the highway. The heavy winter had left behind salted roads that were full of potholes. It was impossible to avoid the holes without the danger of swerving into other cars. I pressed the CD button. I was surprised when a voice, clear and strong, came through loud. It was a CD of Hmong song poetry. A woman's voice told the story of how love was born between a maiden from the Valley of the Wind and a man destined to live where the mountains meet the clouds. I listened to the CD for the 45 minutes drive from St. Paul to Andover, refamiliarizing myself with the poetic form that my father loved. In my father's car, I listened to the melodious rise and the fall of my language. With the poetry around me, it was easy to believe, as my father had done when his songs had come easily, that the entire world was a garden of meaning. I felt my father's voice calling out to me from the rhyme stanzas of the song on the CD. The woman's voice in the car and my father's voice in my heart together yearned, pleaded, begged, and cried. for the rushing river to slow down, for the shifting clouds to halt on their trajectory across the sky, for the moments to converge once more so that feelings could be reawakened. When the car came to a stop in front of our brown house, when my fingers turned off the ignition, I could hear for the first time the silence in our lives, the places where my father's songs had been, and feel the desire to call them forth. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that passage. The phrase that just right at the end there of the entire world was a garden of meaning, just that stayed with me a lot. and I've been thinking about that and thinking about that really not just with this particular book, but really all of your work. And I am wondering sort of how you manage as a writer. You have such, as you said, you're writing your heart and you are sharing that with us. But I feel like that must take a lot out of you in order to write and share in that way. And just wondering how you balance the process and the writing and the putting together of your work with managing the really powerful emotional life of it and the trauma that exists and that you really lay out for us all to experience, but you and your father, I mean, you have to relive it. And so just sort of like wondering how you manage to balance all of that.
I think the journey began long before I knew that I would become a writer or even the impulse to tell a story. When I was just a girl, I was a selective mute in English. I was a selective mute because the world around me felt like it didn't have time for my mom and dad with their halting English, their thick accents. It was apparent that we were newcomers and that the earth that they walked on was unstable. Every step of the way, every word that they put into the world was unstable. And so I was a selective mute, which meant that I had all these big feelings, Elaine, that I couldn't share with a lot of people. I could tell my parents, of course, but it seemed like sometimes they were carrying so much already. And then at school, you know, because I didn't talk, I didn't make a lot of friends. I was a lonely kid. My mom saw an Oprah special, and Oprah said that if you have a kid who doesn't talk, if you have a kid who is perhaps going through a lot of things that aren't in the world, then perhaps you should buy them a journal with a lock and a key. And to my surprise, one day we saw the show together, and one day my mom came back from Kmart with this tiny little journal. Oh, it was the diary with a teddy bear on it, and there was this tiny little lock and a key. And my mom said, "This is for you. You can put everything you need to in here." And that's what I did, and that's what I still do. You know, every once in a while, I'll feel like I'm simmering. You know, and to avoid bubbling over, I'll go to my journal and I'll just write everything in my heart out. I'll write it in cursive so nobody can read it but me. And I'll just write everything out. I'll upload it. That's how I've always seen it. I have to upload the stuff of life so perhaps I could see the beauty that lives within it. And that was the place of artistry for me. And so even today, 41 years old, I journal all the time. And I journal before I write, unless the writing is just burning, and then I'll write it out and then journal after. But usually, you know, if the shower is cold this morning because my beautiful and loving spouse has taken a particularly long shower, then I'll journal that out. That frustration, you know, the coldness of the water hitting my skin, I'll journal all of that out. And by the time I get to the page, the coldness of the water reminds me of the streams of faraway youth, a youth that perhaps is never mine. But wouldn't that be how the mountain streams feel around my mom's ankles or around my father's hands, looking underneath the rocks for all those little fish that he told me about growing up? I become like somebody else almost, and I'm able to travel to a different space. And so journaling is really how I do it. It's been an incredibly effective tool for how I am able to, again, like, use everything and then clear myself up for everything else. But also, I have a beautiful life. I have a blessed life. I have parents who adore me, who remind me all the time that I don't have to do a thing to be loved by them. I have a husband who's truly committed. We've tested this 11 years of marriage. He's pretty committed. And we're blessed with these little children, you know, with all of their magic and all of their blinders and all of the things that they're able to see that I thought was invisible inside of me. You know, yes, they were all five when they realized that they belonged to a small mommy. You know, in a sea of mommies, they realized I was the smallest one. You know, it took them a while to realize that. But in that realization, then they began to see areas of strength that I hadn't even begun to look for within myself. You know, and so the beauty of my life, balanced with all this love, and then the actual practicality of a journal, allows me to meet the world, usually with a pure heart. And I think that is so integral when you're chasing the kind of stories that I'm chasing, when you are looking to harvest from the garden of meaning and find the lessons behind all of our lives, leading all of our lives, guiding all of us.
I'm very grateful for that journal. We've had some questions that have come up in the chat and speaking about that deep connection with your family. And of course, that being the central, your father's being the central story. What was their reaction to the book?
So the launch night came, and we launched this book through the Center for Immigration History at the University of Minnesota. My father sat in the audience. There was about 300 people in the room, and I got up to do a reading from it. And I looked, and my father was just weeping. He was just weeping. It was the first time he heard from the book. The thing was done now. I had given it my best shot. And there he was. He didn't say anything to me during that talk. Afterward, when we were in the car coming back home, he said to me, he said, "Thank you." And he said, "We'll see how the world feels now." You know, and with, you know, the book has been, it was nominated for some of the big literary prizes the year it came out. And every time I go, my dad would say to me, "It doesn't matter what happens, I'll still be here when you come back." You know? And so in many ways, it's been an incredible journey. I said to you earlier, I built my life only because of hope. Hope is the reason why for everything I do. And with every big nomination, I got really, really hopeful. But it was always my father first who caught me in my moments of disappointment. You know, at the Minnesota Book Awards, after everything, my father was there, and he has this tendency, right before they call my name, he goes to the bathroom. And this is just the way it's worked across our lives. So he gets up immediately to go to the bathroom. And my mom said that when he saw me on the stage, he came back down, he wiped his eyes twice, and he blinked away. And he said, "That's not the ghost of my daughter." And so it's been incredible, such a gift to be able to say to someone you love, for them to hear you say it, that I honor you, I honor the story you live. And while your art may not have had as much room to travel, mine can go the distance. We're on one team.
I needed to give that a little bit of a moment to sink in. Yeah. I wonder, sort of in this story and thinking about your work and the song poet, sort of how can this book, or do you think this book, or how can this book bring forward or invite other communities to share stories? You, I think, with Somewhere in the Known World as well, you're bringing in these different refugee stories and I think do invite others to also share them. But we got several questions. This is maybe a little bit of a messy question, but several questions around, you know, what advice you have for aspiring writers or other young Hmong writers or writers from other immigrant communities. And so we'd just love to have you talk to us a little bit about how you see this, maybe as a model or what you'd like to share about that.
You know, one of the first public readings that I'd ever done was on the Latehomecomer. It was at a United Nations conference in New York City. And I finished the reading, and then, you know, it was my tendency then to finish read as quickly as I can and then sit right down. And that's exactly what I did. But afterward, there were two women waiting for me One of them was from Africa, another from Europe. And they both said to me, you know that you're telling her story too. I thought I was telling my grandmother's story. I thought perhaps I was telling my own history and documenting that for the future. But in that moment, I understood the role of literature in an entirely different way, you know? And with that realization, I understood the task that I wanted to set for myself as a writer. I didn't want to go about writing the same book every time, but these stories were more than just one. These refugee narratives were around the world. In the Minnesota context, it's particularly important because while we are not high for diversity as a state, we're home to more refugees per capita than any other state in the nation. You know, we are in that way the heartbeat, the refuge of America. And so with all of these books, I hope that what I'm doing is I'm inspiring different communities to tell their own story, but also that I might use some of the skills I've learned on this journey to help facilitate these stories in the life that we live in our classrooms, for example. You know, we all know what happened in Afghanistan this summer. In Somewhere in the Unknown World, I wrote about Afghani's story, a brilliant young person who was USA Ho Chi Minh said, would you like to help build Afghanistan? And of course, he and all his brilliance, optimism said, of course. And what happens then is the Taliban starts calling, and in the end, Afghani flees, $25,000 US, the international human trafficking rate, to leave in the hopes of being free, being alive. The moment he leaves, his father disappears. Anyway, Afghani's family was among those outside of the airport in Kabul when the bombs went off. And just a month ago, his mother, on her way to the market to buy food for the family, she was stoned for having mothered an infidel, a traitor. The stories that I write about are very alive. The wars that I write about are alive in the hearts and the minds of the people who live through them. And in that way, I hope that what I'm able to do in my work is to develop some of the images that they've carried in their heart, you know, to put into words some of the feelings that they've harbored for so long. In that way, to make room for some new possibilities. You know, so there is, has always been, I think, guiding me in each book that I adventure into, this understanding that while I'm telling these particular stories, there's a whole world waiting to hear them. A writer like me is fairly rare to be among one of the first for a people, to have somehow the balance of this incredible poverty and these circumstances. I was born a stateless child, but then to have one of the best education that money can buy, you know, and to be able to do this kind of work, to use all of these stories and build a foundation for something bigger. Such a gift and a blessing. And I think I feel that every time I go into the page, every time I have an opportunity like this one and all of the others granted by the Friends and, you know, the Center for the Book, to share my stories with the world, to engage with it, I understand that it is an honor and a blessing. It is a gift that I've been given, and perhaps that the stories I bring into the world are also a gift. And this is really the heart of, I think, my response to all of those writers out there looking to tell their stories. Your stories are your gifts to the world. You have to honor them as such. So often, I think we try to find structures that would fit them, or perhaps to make them more accessible to others, or to be into submission. But that's not how stories work. You are a vessel for the life you live. You are a vessel for the lives around you, for those memories that have been gifted you. That is your inheritance. And with that, what do you build in the world? What do you build for the world? I think these kinds of guiding questions are more productive, you know? And so that's a space that I work from every time. And then there are different ways where I make it fun for me. The Latehomecomer cannot be like the song poet, structurally. The song poet cannot be like someone in the unknown world. So there are always all of these challenges because I want to grow as a writer. I'm turning 41 soon. I've been on this path since I was 22. But I know that the writer I will be at 60 if I am blessed with that amount of time to do this work that I'm so passionate about. The writer will be very different from the one I am today, mm-hmm. because I want to try. Again, perfection should not be the goal. It is the imperfect, you know, realities of our lives that make us who we are. And Elaine, who we are is a beautiful thing. You as an actress, you know, and me as a writer, we understand that's what we do when we do our thing. We portray the beauty of being imperfect, the beauty of being small in a big world.
Mm-hmm. There is so much beauty in that life and in the life that you've shared in the song poet and the imperfections and the struggles and that journey. And you referenced it a little bit when you were talking about the education that you were able to receive. And we had a question from one of our listeners or viewers tonight around, she said that she was, as she was reading, she felt a little troubled by the description of the tension in your family when you and your sister were going to college and seemingly moving ahead of your parents' education, and thinking what you were just talking about being the vessel and the sharing of stories and this and the immigrant experience, and frequently, you know, when you have a first generation college student and what that would mean in the family. It was so moving to watch what was happening in your family throughout that. Can you share a little bit more or describe that a little more? Do you still feel that difference in educational attainment is a barrier? Has it lessened, or do you still see that?
So there are many different ways to approach this question. And I think the way that makes most sense for me in the current space where I occupy, I'm now a parent as well, you know? And of course, with every child, with every life that enters yours, their hopes and dreams, you know? And I want them to be healthy, and I want them to be happy, and I want them to do work that they're so passionate about that they can build lives on, not just one life, but many lives on. So I understand some of the yearning of my mom and dad. The goal was always that my older sister and I, the younger ones, that we're able to lead healthier lives, happier lives where the work that we do can build the stuff of our dreams, you know, that we're not just standing by machines trying to meet quotas day in and day out. Recently, I wrote a series of letters for Al Jazeera, letters to a refugee child. And in one of those letters, I talk about how this new country, this new place, it will break the way you see the people who love most. It will change that forever. You know, and I think all the time about how this is beyond education, but it is so much foundational to it. And it is, in fact, the foundation of my education. When I came to America, I was taught that you don't eat with your mouth open. I was taught this lesson in a really kind of cruel way, unintentional, but that's sometimes how cruelty works. Sometimes cruelty can be innocent. We were sitting at lunch. I was in school, and we had French toast sticks and sausage patties for lunch. And it was so sweet and so sweet, and it felt like the whole thing was just a treat. So I was eating as I knew how to eat. You eat it, you chew it down, you swallow it. My mouth was open. And slowly the whole of the table stopped eating, and everybody was looking at me. And when I noticed that they were looking at me, again, I'm stubborn. And so I'm like, I'm not going to stop eating. I'm not going to show these kids one more time that my mom and dad, that they didn't know how to teach me for this world that we're now in. Because the kids started mimicking me, and I could tell that's where it was all going. But I refused to stop. And eventually I choked on the food because I was also crying. And I was taken to the principal's office. And there was a Hmong man, an interpreter. And he said to me, what's going on? And I told him. And then he said, in this country, you have to learn how to do things the way other people do them to survive. Those words have stayed with me, you know? And I remember eating with my mouth closed the next day and sitting at our dining table and seeing the way my mom and my dad were eating and thinking, should I say something or not? And I decided not to say anything. And I think that was a great decision, because in the space of our table, I inhabit the realities of our lives so fully and so completely. And it's such a gift. You know, it's such a gift to be able to eat and to live and to sustain what is inside our hearts and our families, but also to enter, to in many ways, to blow open those doors and invite the world in. So I'm no longer embarrassed about these things, but education changed on that level and many other levels, the ways in which I saw the people who loved me most and put me in a position where I was able to make certain decisions to safeguard what mattered to me. You know, and so those tensions, I don't think they ever go away. I think they change, and they change with time. A long time ago, my mom and dad were the ones who taught me how to dream. And Elaine, in the writing of this book, but also its trajectory and the trajectory of my career, I've enlarged their dream. You know, for me, they didn't know. Now they think maybe something else is possible. And so 41 years old, practically, and I still live in the space of possibility. And that's the way I want to live. My dreams are not smaller today. In fact, they've grown bigger than when I was 21. And I think that is possible because of all of these things, and always because education is a gift. I've always believed that fact. Education is a gift. And when we get to become educated, there are decisions that we have to make. And those decisions are never easy, but in the end, they're everything that matters.
Yeah, it is so resonant, having just tracked through the story of your family and thinking through the passages with your sister and how she would analyze the different schools and then determine that you needed to move to a different school because of the various factors and tracking all of that with that goal of attaining that education that was going to mean, you know, open up all of those doors and open up all of these possibilities. And that was really powerful to have that through line. And speaking of possibilities, I think that it would be great to hear a little bit about the other life that the song poet is going to have with the collaboration with the Minnesota Opera. And I know that you're writing the libretto, so that must be like a whole nother writing experience for you.
It is. So we have to go back a little bit before the pandemic days. There was a beautiful human being called Jamie Andrews, who's still in the world, but he was with the Minnesota Opera. And when he read the song poet, he said it was so clear to him that this is the stuff of great opera. And so Jamie said, emailed me one day and said, would you ever be interested in meeting and talking about possibilities? And I'm like, yeah, I would love to meet you. And so we met at a beloved cafe of my Golden Time Cafe in Rondo. I love that place. We met there and we talked about this idea of a youth opera. Jamie was then in charge of education programming, and he thought, a youth opera, would you be interested? And of course I was. It would be the first time the Hmong story is translated into the operatic stage. It would be the first time that the form opens itself up to this incredible oral tradition that I come from to honor the songs of my father. And so we had this incredible conversation. We created an incredible team of people, and I wrote a youth libretto. And then the pandemic hit, and the youth libretto could not come out because you cannot train youth how to sing, particularly in a libretto that contains also Hmong words in some parts, you know, via a virtual format like this one. Sure. And then just this last month, I received a call from Ryan Taylor, who's the CEO of Minnesota Opera. And Ryan said, Kalia, how do you feel about making this a main stage production? And I always thought, Elaine, that this was a main stage production, because it speaks to that beating heart of what art is, because it speaks to the beating heart of who we are as a place, Minnesota as a place. There were so many points of relevance. And so, of course, I said yes, but that means that I have to adapt this youth libretto that I wrote into an adult one. And that's been such an incredible experience. I think this will be a really unique opera because of the way it began and the way it will end. It becomes this incredible family experience, intergenerational, but also an experience, I think, that is as rich as life, that is as rich as I want my career to be in literature, to write for children, but also write for adults, and each to write of a timelessness, to approach that place, that current that runs above all of us, where you can speak to the dead and the dead can speak to you, and somehow time becomes just this thread that holds us together and not pulls us apart. And so we're doing this thing. I've sent in the adaptation to Jocelyn Hagen, who's doing the music, Rick Shiomi, who is doing the stage direction. And now we're a bigger team than we were before. And it will premiere in the fall of 2023. I believe it will come out along with Handel. But this news will all be formally announced in February when the Minnesota Opera announces their season. But I'm super excited about this project. And that's the beauty of it. Every book has its own destiny. As much as there was for me to learn about the song poet, it continues its work in the world, and it continues to teach me on this journey that I'm on as an artist and a writer.
Oh, I can't wait. I am tremendously excited as well. Anytime I've ever had the opportunity to experience opera, you have, or I have had sort of that feeling of sometimes your chest just sort of like opening up out into, you know, into this space. And I feel that with your work, even on the written page. And so I think that I and many, many, many others will be tremendously excited to experience that in the opera as well. So that is marvelous. Do you have anything that you'd like to share with us beyond the libretto that's happening of what you're working on next?
Yes.
Now?
So I am writing a middle grade novel with Andrew Carr from Dutton. Andrew happens to be local, works for Dutton, but happens to be local. And Andrew is doing some of the most exciting middle grade and young adult work in the field, bar none. So I'm super excited. That project is called The Diamond Explorer, about a young Hmong boy born on the Minnesota prairie who is destined to become a great shaman, except all the great shamans in his life are dead. And that book, it is fiction, so it allows me to tangle some of the questions and preoccupations of my life. You know, what is this idea of the ancestral village if everybody has their own? You know, when dad dies, maybe he'll go to his parents, but mom wants to return to her mom and dad too. Does this mean that we each have our own, right? If we have this boy who can travel across different realms, wouldn't he be able to discover that for me? You know, and of course, tangle with things like cancer. There are so many people in my family and my community in our world battling with incredible illness, disease. I mean, we're in a pandemic right now. You know, what does that mean for the spirit of a person, the spiritual life of a people? And so that all for a middle grade novel, it's a big project, but I'm doing it with the right person. So I'm really excited about that. And then 2022 will be abnormally quiet for me. In this pandemic, I've had 5 books come out. So 2022 will be quiet. And then 2023, all of these other books will come out, including one called Rock in My Throat. And that's a children's book about selective mutism and loneliness in childhood, something that I know a great deal about. And then I am working on right now, finishing a draft for Atria Books, Return of the Refugee, My Mother's Story. It's a story that I've carried for a long time, but I knew I couldn't write it until I became a mother. If I became a mother, when I discovered the kind of mother I would perhaps be. I've always known how the story would end, but I didn't know where it would begin. And so I'm working on that. And of course it ends while my mother, who left her mother at the age of 16 to journey into this life with my father and then all of us, when she returns to Laos, to the burial place of her mother. She always said, as she would tell her mother everything that happened, you know, from the point of 16 on, she would tell her mother that all of that love, those first 16 years of love, that it was enough to carry her through a lifetime. And so when we finally went 4 years ago, perhaps that's what I was hoping for and expecting, all of these words and stories to come forth for my mom. But the thing that came out was the cry of a girl. The girl that she had been when she left her mother, that's what came out. And so I spent the last 4 years reflecting, but also talking to my mother about what a return would look like for a refugee. Would it be a return to the womb? Would it be a return to all of these stories that were lost? What is found? It's been an incredible 4 years of incredible conversations. And so with my mother's blessing, I'm finishing up a draft of Return of the Refugee for Atria Books. So lots of projects.
A lot. And as you mentioned, you do have three young children at home too. So a lot to balance in your life.
Goodness. It is, but it's also such a gift. I'm also teaching at the University of Minnesota. If anybody has children at the U or grandchildren or nieces or nephews, I'm the Etta Stone Keller Writer in Residence at the U in the MFA program. So I teach young people how to write.
Wonderful. I can't imagine a better experience than having you in that writer in residence position and being able to learn from you in that way. I am so grateful for all that you've shared with us this evening. And there have been a lot of comments in the chat to that along those lines as well. It is such a gift to us as readers that you are willing to open up your heart and your story and your family to us so that we can see all of the possibilities that you write about. And so thank you very, very much for being a part of this. I want to remind everyone that you still have the opportunity to access The Song Poet, A Memoir of My Father from eBooks Minnesota. That'll be available through Sunday, December 19th. The link is there in the chat and both in the eBook and the audiobook. And I highly recommend checking out the audiobook because then you get to hear Kalia read the entire book. So is there any final word or thing that you'd like to say to any of us tonight, Kalia?
Yes. You know, in the Hmong culture, we believe that when an OER goes, you can ask for it to carry some of your sorrows, but you can also ask for it to carry some of your gratitude. Because there are forces in the world that are hungry for these things. And so we're ending an old year, we're welcoming a new, and I just want all of you to, of course, to let the old year carry some of the heavy in your heart so that you have room for the new. So all of you, I want to thank you for joining me and joining the Song Poet, along with the Center for the Book for this adventure. I hope to see you all in the world when this pandemic is over. If we're still able to be together, we will be stronger for this. We will be more beautiful for this. And Elaine, personally, I want to thank you for, in many ways, walking this journey with me. It's been an honor for me to see you grow, and also astounding to see your love for the arts and your passion and support for artists. So thank you. It's such an honor.
Thank you very, very much. This was a tremendous, tremendous evening. So thank you to everyone who has been a part of tonight. We do want to hear what you think about this program and the event, so be on the lookout for a brief questionnaire. I will send a link to the recording of today's event to all who registered as well. As always, I leave these programs with an even greater appreciation for the thoughtful readers of our state and the amazing writers such as you, Kalia. Thank you so much to everyone for being a part of One Book, One Minnesota, and good night.